All right, I want to welcome everyone to Nancy's Creek United Methodist Church today. Sorry for the delay, but I guess things happen when you when you think you got everything ready and it's not. But God is good.
All the time.
And we appreciate everything that he continues to do for us. First thing, I want to welcome all the ones on the pew today, and I want to welcome all the ones online. The title of the sermon today is going to be Provision Provided by Miracles. Provision provided by miracles. Let's start with prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Skyler, if you will, go ahead and give us our scripture for today, please, sir.
Chapter 5. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them, and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, Launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men.
Amen. Word of God for the people of God. From now on you'll catch men. Christianity basically began with a fish story. The disciples had finished all night on the Sea of Galilee and had finished that night and had caught nothing. They had dragged their nets through the cold, murky water. And each time that they pulled their nets in, they had great expectations of things to be there for them, only to find nothing. The sign of Christianity is a fish. And St. Peter, he is called the big fisherman. I saw a sign the other day that said, born to fish, but forced to work. Everyone has a fish story. I know they do. I've got fish stories. I know that when the men started walking on the moon, I was in Gunnersville with my brother, and we were trot line fishing out on the big water up there, and he had all of these trot lines and different things, and we would go out and set them out, and then we would go out a little later and pull them all in, hoping with great expectation that there would be fish on the trot line, because that's how he made a living, was taking the fish to the fish market and selling them. And also we had the opportunity to eat a lot of the fish. Fish stories. I bet everyone in here got fish stories. But let's read this fish story and see what the Lord has to say to us. Luke 5, 1 through 7, and then verse 11. And so it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake Gennesaret. This is the Sea of Galilee and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon Peter's boat, and asked him to push out a little from the land. And he sat down and he taught the multitude from the boat. It's amazing how the water will let the boys carry further than if you're on the land with obstacles. But I want you to know that the Bible says that obedience is better than sacrifice. When he stopped speaking, he said to Simon Peter, said, launch out into the deep. Let down your nets for a catch. But Simon Peter answered him and said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night, and we caught nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and there was to the point that the nets began to break. And so they signaled for their partners in the other ship to come over, and they put down their nets, and they kept pulling in fish to the point that the boats began to sink. You know, that's prosperity right there. That's when we're receiving so much prosperity that God has blessed us with. And then they did something that was kind of unique. They did something like every Christian is supposed to do, but most of them don't. They forsook everything and followed him. Let's pray. Father, bless this word. Bless this message, and let us today understand the miracles of the prosperity, and that it is something that God wants to place on every Christian person. He wants to bless them beyond measure. He wants to continue to do for them and show them how merciful and grateful he is. He's a good God. Amen. Glory in the name of Jesus. And the children of God said, amen. Amen. Failure sometimes comes before success. The success story begins with failure. There are two boats on the beach and they are empty and the nets are being washed. And the frustrated fishermen who tried their way, who tried their very best, were angry. And they spit out the words, we have toiled all night and taken nothing. They were unsuccessful fishermen. But on the lips of businessmen and pastors and salesmen and housewives and school teachers who have toiled all week, all month, and often feel like they have accomplished nothing. Are you frustrated about your limited success financially, professionally, academically, and romantically in your life? You know, there are three kinds of people in this congregation and those watching us on media today. There are only three kinds. Those who are married, those who want to marry, and those who are sorry they ever got married. Are you frustrated with your lack of success? Have you tried your best and produced nothing? Make failure your teacher, not your undertaker. Every miracle of Jesus had a message in it. And this message of the miracle is, try again. If at first you don't succeed, try again. Jesus got into Simon Peter's boat and gave him a command. He said, launch out into the deep. Do something new. do something different. Jesus was saying, I know you've tried your best. I know you're frustrated. I know that you're completely failed. But I want you to try again. I want you to do one more time. Be persistent. You know, even the snail and the turtles were persistent as they strived to get on the ark before the floods came. I would have probably ran out and grabbed the board that the snail was on and brought him into the ship myself instead of waiting on him to crawl there. Sometimes, though, as human beings, we have to crawl to get where we're going. We have to do whatever it takes. We need to be persistent in our life. Persistency finds a way while others are looking for an excuse. You're not finished until you think you are. If you think that you dare not, you won't do it. If you think you won't win, you can't. If you think that you're outclassed, you are. But if you think of yourself as a champion, you can be. Because God looks at you not as a failure, but he looks at you with the success that he's given you, because on the inside of us is the Spirit of Almighty God. The Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, the same Spirit that fed the 5,000 fishes and loaves to the people, the same Jesus that raised people from the dead, the same Jesus that healed people everywhere he went, that same Spirit is on the inside of us. But we have to learn to be a servant. This miracle story is a story of being a servant. After fishing all night, the disciples beached their boats, washed their nets, and mended the rips and tears and got the rocks out of the nets. And suddenly, there was excitement in the village. The streets are packed following a young rabbi, this Jesus of Nazareth. The crowd pushed down to the very edge of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus got into Simon's boat and commanded him to push out from the land. The point is, he taught them how to be servants before he taught them to be disciples. How to be servants in the kingdom of Almighty God. Servants. If you mention that in the churches today, there's usually a stampede for the back door. All most Christians want to be is instead of a servant, is a consultant to God. And tell him what they need and when they need it and where they need it. And they just want God to be their little fairy and answer whatever they're hoping and wishing for. Many people, they're not even willing to serve God. Just consult. The mental image of being a servant frustrates most Christians. Some Christians are only in the reserve army of God. They only come to church on Easter and Christmas. Some people come every day, but they refuse to give up what they have to God. We see a servant as someone who bent over, crushed in spirit, lacking in self-esteem, dirty, wrinkled, weary, and exploited. The attempt of this generation towards the servant is they don't want anything to do with it. It's like J.B. Phillips said in his commandments, and he said, blessed are the pushers, for they get their way. Blessed are the hard-boiled, because they never get hurt. Blessed are those who complain because they get all the attention. Blessed are the ones who are slave drivers, for they get results. Blessed are the greedy, because they always get what they want. But the Bible says, don't be selfish. The attitude of the average Christian in America today is, I'll serve if I can be seen, recognized, appreciated. If you'll put me at the forefront, let me sing on television, if you'll make the big man out of me, make me a speaker where I am the one who gets the attention. I am the one up front doing everything. I am that type of person. I'll be wonderful, Lord, if I can serve you like that, if I can be the big man. We all want the Lord to love us. Amen. You know, Lord, I have served you with great emotion, favor, in the limelight. You know, I've eagerly spoke when I spoke at the men's conference at the club. You know, I resonate when I promote fellowship groups. You know, Lord, all the things that I do when I can be the big man and out front. Study when I'm the keynote speaker, when I'm the head singer, when I'm the one out front, Lord. That's what we as Christians want to be, is recognized because we're so great and wonderful. But I want you to know that we should humble ourselves before the mighty hand of Almighty God. Amen. Praise be to him forever. Amen. Sir, you know, the Bible said the greatest of all of these is the servant of all. Think about that. Matthew 23:11, he that is the greatest among you is the servant of all. Galatians 5:13, for you were called to freedom, brethren. Listen only, do not turn your freedom into the opportunities of the flesh. But be through love, serve one another. Hear this phrase, through love, serve one another. I want America to hear that today. Amen. We need love in the churches. We need love in the streets. We need love in our government. We need to serve one another, but serve one another through love. Amen. Spiritual praise. We need to give God the glory for all that he does. The Bible says every good and perfect gift comes from above. But you, as Christian people, are needed. We are needed. We are the children of God. The Bible said, let our light so shine. Jesus said to Peter, push out from the deep. I need you. I need your boat. But if you can't serve, you can't be a disciple. Why call you me Lord, Lord, and not do the things I say for you to do? Christianity is a doing faith. So days when we stand before the Lord and he's going to ask us at a judgment, what have you done for me? What did you do? Jesus said, he that is the greatest among you is the servant of all. Let us remember as we live our lives that God in heaven has empowered us to do the impossible. You have that authority. What are we doing with it? Because until you move from a servant to a disciple, you can't do what God has for you. But first, you have to make it to the point of a servant. You need faith. Jesus said to Peter, launch out in the deep. And there's five good reasons why. Peter could have told Jesus, well, that's nonsense. Jesus said, launch out into the deep. It was the wrong place. Every professional fisherman in the time of Simon Peter knew that you caught fish along the shallow waters by the edge of the lake with the nets. A net in the middle of the Sea of Galilee had a drag factor. Instead of about 3 feet, they was 175 feet of water. What nonsense was this? But we are to submit to God. Secondly, he could have rebelled because it was in the daylight. That's the wrong time for fish. Everybody knows that if you're going to fish, you fish at night. At night's when you're able to catch the fish. But they had fished all night and couldn't catch anything. But we do not need to be rebellious against God. Peter could have rebelled because of the frustrating factor in his life, because they had toiled all night. They were tired. They were cold. He was disappointed, frustrated on the catch that he had. All of this was going on in Peter's mind, but instead of him being frustrated, you know, because Jesus was in the boat. Are you feeling like a failure? Get Jesus in the boat. Are you frustrated? Get Jesus in the boat. Are you having trouble with your marriage? Is it a war zone? Get Jesus in the boat. Have you lost your joy? Get Jesus in the boat. Are you weary about the future? We need to get Jesus in the boat. Public opinion is another reason why Jesus might have disobeyed, or Peter disobeyed Jesus. There were many fishermen on the bank, and they were listening to what this carpenter had told Peter to do. This carpenter had told him, you know, the people on the bank would probably have just laughed at him. Fish in the deep with a net in the daytime? What a joke. It's like fishing from Moby Dick with a cane pole. Public opinion must never influence our obedience to God. Do not allow public opinion to control your speech. It's called political correctness. Public opinion has called pornography art, but it's not art, it's trash. Public opinion has called profanity pre-speech. Public opinion has called adultery free love. It's not free and it's not love. Public opinion has called abortion the freedom of choice. Freedom of choice did not give you the right to commit murder of an unborn child. And the fifth reason that Peter might have disobeyed the command to launch out into the deep was absolute contrariness. You know, we have a lot of Christians today who are just contrary. They just don't want to be told what to do. They don't want to do anything. Most Christians would just come into the church and sit on the pews. And you know, the devil is okay with you doing that as long as you keep your mouth shut and don't do anything for God. But you know, without faith, it's impossible to please God. If you're waiting to understand, you're going to wait a long time. God does not explain himself. He just tells you what to do. Moses would have died on the backside of the desert if he hadn't gone back into Egypt like God told him to do. Obey God. Like I said, obedience is better than sacrifice. God has a plan for you. The Bible says, and this gospel shall be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end shall come. You know, we all say, well, it doesn't cost anything to be a Christian. Oh, it doesn't cost anything to be a child of God. But I want you to know it costs you everything if you're really a child of God. The Bible says that they forsook their boats, their nets, their families, their future plans, and they followed Jesus. You know, there's a story about this man who walks into a jewelry store and he wants to buy a pearl of great price that he sees there, that he loves that pearl and he wants it so bad. And so he tells the seller, I want to buy this, and how much will it cost? And the seller tells him, well, it's going to cost everything that you have. He said, well, I've got $10,000. He said, all right, I'll take it. He said, what else do you have? He said, I don't have anything but a wallet, and I got a few fives and a 20. The seller said, well, I'll take that. He said, what else have you got? He said, I don't have anything else. I guess I'll go home. Oh, you have a home? I'll take that. Oh, you want me to live in my motor home? Well, I'll take your motor home. You've got one of those? He said, what do you want me to do, sleep in my car? He said, yeah. He said, I'll take your car. He said, I got two of them. He said, I'll take both of them. When it costs you everything, it means everything. He said, you mean you want my wife and child? He said, yes, I'll take them too. I'll take everything that you have. When you become a Christian, you forsake everything and follow Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Isn't God good?
All the time.
All the time. And to God be the glory. Father, I just thank you and praise you for this wonderful day, this day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be